What's up, everybody, and welcome to the Press X Podcast, episode 57, your weekly podcast for gaming news and opinions coming at you each and every Monday at noon Eastern. I am Kevin McManus. With me, Nick Hassell.
Where's Kellen?
Gone. We're filming that gamer versus gamer thing, finally, after this, so we're trying to get this out of the way so we don't have to worry about it, so we can focus solely on that, because I don't want to miss that release date.
And just kidding, I know he's sleeping, so.
it was rhetorical.
Yeah.
I do want to do a little bit of housekeeping, and that in particular is that Joseph Woolard won the Tomb Raider, Rise of the Tomb Raider giveaway. I sent you a message. If you send one back, I will send you that code. You have a week. I put that in the fine print of the message. You have a week, and then if you don't answer, I'll give it to someone else. Other than that, let's move into what we start the show with, which is what we are playing.
Mm-hmm.
I have a long list, so I'll let you start.
Okay, fair enough. I am mostly only playing Tales of Berseria on PC and Yakuza 0 still on PS4. I think I'm about 10 hours in Yakuza 0 and a little, I'd say about 18 in Tales. Haven't got to play too much this week. This is literally my last week to kind of get out of playing games and stuff like that. I think I've already sent you and Kellen my list of stuff coming up.
It's a long list.
Game releases, and
it's only till April.
There's at least one week or one game per week, if not more, every single week, all the way up through April, like you said. So I don't really have the excuse anymore to be like, oh, I missed out, or I wanted to sleep tonight, or something like that. So this is my last week of goofing around, so I should have about 20 hours in both games, but I know I've been kind of slacking in some regards. But Tails, only getting better, got more characters to run around with. Combat's better, I'm leveling up, so I'm a lot more powerful now, and that's always the fun part of those games for me is crushing people so I can like bump up the difficulty and get more treasure and blah blah blah. So it's just kind of like a cycle. Get stronger, make it harder, get stronger, make it harder, and then you're pretty much like beast mode through the end of the game. And Yakuza 0 is just ridiculous. It's just some of the stuff that goes on. It's a pretty entertaining little city, I guess, for the most part, and it's in the 80s. I don't know if I ever mentioned that last week or not. So that just adds to the ridiculousness of it even more. And fun game. I haven't put as much time into it yet, but I'll get to it before next week's onslaught.
We were talking earlier off camera about the PlayStation exclusive lineup so far just this month. The other one, Yakuza, another one that I forgot.
Mm-hmm.
Tales and Gravity Rush.
It's a very Asian heavy start to the year, which I'm fine with.
Me too.
A lot of these games, like, you're hitting a lot of weird genres or like in between genres and stuff like that with these games. So I like it before these AAA games show up.
Is that it for you?
I also tried Fire Emblem Heroes, the mobile game.
Oh, yeah.
It was pretty cool. I played only a couple hours of it because the other mobile game, the Bleach one that I played, kind of took over. It was a big week to start February off. But played a little bit of Fire Emblem Heroes. Plays exactly like the actual mobile games on 3DS. So,
do you feel like it's nagging you for money, or do you think it's pretty hands-off with
it? It's pretty good. And like I said, a lot of games have a sort of system, not to dive too far into it, but they have a lot of systems where you'll get this cool character, but oh, it's a 3-star. This one, oh, it's 4-star. Oh, okay, cool, I got the 5-star version. This one, if you get the 1-star, he can go all the way up to the 5-star. So it eliminates that sort of aspect of the game where you feel like you're getting kind of fooled by RNG, I guess, something like that. So you can just spend more time if you don't get the cool guy or the cool girl that you wanted. So that's cool. It's not one of those where like every 5 minutes a message pops up. You could have this if you paid, like sort of like an MMO does. So no, it's not nagging at all. And
cool.
Yeah, just my phone battery doesn't last much anymore with those two games going. So yeah, but having fun, and we'll get to some bigger games, I guess, next week. But yeah, like it's just, I'm looking at my social life. I'm just like, dude, you got to go away until about May. and then once May hits, then movies and stuff like that start coming into the picture. So I don't know. I don't know what I'm going to do this year besides play games, but we'll see.
So my list, I have a very Kingdom Hearts heavy, another exclusive that came
out. Just wake me up when you're done.
Speaking of waking, the first one is Birth by Sleep. Finally finished that. It's multiple characters. You have to beat all their stories, and then there's like the final story. I beat the third person story that I needed to and did the final story. I Dream Drop Distance HD, which was the 3DS one, which in the timeline leads up to Kingdom Hearts 3. It was on 2.8. Went through that entire game in 2 days. Game significantly shorter than most other Kingdom Hearts games. It took me like 15 hours to get through. It was not a lot at all. Compared to the other ones. Very much liked it. Camera feels a little weird because it's so zoomed out compared to all the other ones, but the worlds are way bigger, which is weird to say because it's on the 3DS, but they never put out anything on the PS3. They never put out a PS4 exclusive thing. So, like, the jump from the PS2 to the 3DS was like, whoa!
Yeah, shorter game and weird camera. Sounds like mobile, but... more stuff doesn't really sound like a mobile version.
No, no, this is one of the best Kingdom Hearts games by far. It's really good. The reason the camera is zoomed out is because the worlds are multiple times bigger than all the other ones that they used before. So they had to make a way to have you get through the worlds faster. So they added this thing called flow motion. And basically, if you roll, you hit square to roll. If you roll into like handrails or the wall, it kind of jet set radios and you grind and you get a lot of speed so you can zip through the maps quicker. And that's why the camera zoomed out, because I think if it was zoomed in, you wouldn't know what was going on. But anyway, Beat Birth by Sleep, really liked it. It was my, Dream Drop Distance, really liked it. It was my first time playing through that. Finished Birth by Sleep finally 10 years later. Watched the Kingdom Hearts Unchained Key hour-long video thing that's on 2.8. Liked it way more than I thought it would. I thought it was going to be a lot like the Final Fantasy like 10.5 thing that they did, which was just this really awkward like 30-minute movie that was terrible. This was interesting. It set up a couple plot points for Kingdom Hearts 3. It was actually really important, and it was the cutscenes from the mobile game. So if you're not playing the mobile game, you're not getting the full Kingdom Hearts story. I'm sorry. Oh my gosh, if they could spread this thing out through more platforms, that would be phenomenal. Thank you guys. But actually, very interesting for what it was, and if you're a fan of Kingdom Hearts, you'll at least enjoy it. And then the big one, which was Kingdom Hearts 0.2 Birth by Sleep, A Fragmentary Passage. This was the big part of the 2.8. It is the Kingdom Hearts 3 engine. This is what Kingdom Hearts 3 is going to feel like. And for people who've played Kingdom Hearts, it is Kingdom Hearts 2 meets Birth by Sleep with a little bit of Dream Drop Distance. They took the combats of basically the best three and put them together. The magic works more like Final Fantasy 15 in that you kind of use it less, but it's devastating. It'll just wipe everything out, and basically you have a magic meter, and if you use one spell continuously, like you use thunder a couple times, then you'll get an action thing where you can hit triangle and cast thunderaja or whatever it is, the one with the J, which is the super powerful one, and then the animation starts and the screen strikes with lightning and everything dies and it looks really cool. So it's very satisfying combat. I liked it. I wish that they stuck. I actually like Birth by Sleep's combat the best. I wish that they stuck completely with that, but I like this one. Graphics looks great. Story, don't want to get into it. Kingdom Hearts fans can figure that out. It's convoluted. The only thing I want to say is don't start here. Do not be like, oh, Kingdom Hearts. I've heard this series is pretty good. Let me hop in on.
Well, the number's confusing.
2.8.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If it says 0.2, you kind of think that goes before 1.
Yeah, Birth by Sleep does take place before 1, and this is a sequel to Birth by Sleep, but it's a whole mess. The timeline's a joke, but it finishes, literally the last cutscene in it is called 2.9. So we are at 3. They can't go back now, unless we get a 2.95.
Yeah, it almost feels like they're doing some Metal Gear stuff, where it's like, okay, I'll start from the beginning, Metal Gear 1. No, that's not the beginning. So
yeah, well,
not as bad, obviously, but
so the thing about this, and I figured this out, this series is The Matrix, absolutely.
Okay.
It is The Matrix trilogy, and I played all these with my girlfriend, and I kind of explained that to her, and she's like, yeah, that makes sense. The first one's a simple story. That's just, here's the story. It's contained. It makes sense. Good job, you did it. The second one adds all these ridiculous things that they totally didn't need. It makes the story super convoluted. It adds, just ridiculous stuff. Everything else is the Animatrix. They're all mini little side stories that are important, but they just have a little bit of push and pull here. And then Kingdom Hearts 3 is going to be the war one, where it's, this is the finale, this is what we've built it up to, and I'm very nervous for that because The Matrix 3 was not very good.
Took a lot of explaining.
But yeah, so anyway, I'm officially caught up on Kingdom Hearts. I've done all of the games.
You did
in
it.
The past 15 years.
Now you just have to wait 10 more years.
Now in 2019, I get
now
to play
you can
Kingdom
forget
Hearts.
It all by then.
I get to play Kingdom Hearts 3. Other than that, two real quick things that I played. Res Infinite, I finally beat. Mm-hmm. And I beat Area X in VR. It is absolutely awesome. Very much liked it. Looked into it. There's like alternate routes that you can take because in... Res is a rail shooter, yeah. But Res Area X, the VR one, isn't. You move where you look. Mm-hmm. So it's like big open areas that you can kind of fly around. There's alternate paths you can take with alternate bosses and stuff. So I will be going back to do that. The other one I played was Bound, which was a game I've been wanting to play. They put out a demo. They put the game on sale. Very interesting. I really liked it in VR, and I played it again without VR and was like, eh. Mm-hmm. Like, VR totally spoiled me for the game. Basically, you play as a dancer. Everything is very cel-shaded / fantastical. Like, nothing makes sense. The walls all pulse. Mm-hmm. The camera, when you swing the camera through the wall, like, deteriorates. Like, it crumbles so that you can get through. And then when the camera finishes going through, it rebuilds itself, things like that. But your character is a dancer. Their animation's awesome. The way they ballerina around and they attack doing, like, these spins and such. Really liked it. One thing about VR I will say is the default VR settings are mediocre. They're basically fixed camera angles where you can look around and it looks like you're looking at a diorama, which is my favorite. I love third person. This game's third person. Mm-hmm. I love third person VR. I think it's better than first person. It looks like you're playing with little dolls, basically, like a toy set or something, a diorama.
Something you're very used to, right?
Oh, all the time. So... if you go into your settings, you can set the camera onto the or off the comfort mode, which puts the camera like a regular video game behind the character, but you can still control it and look around, and that is a much better way to play the game. But
I almost wish PS VR had its own like sub menu in the PS4 like interface where you can just set up
how you want it for every game, but almost like a user profile. Like if this is an option, do this. Yeah, that'd be nice actually.
I mean. At least so far with the games that I've seen, they don't, like, if you play this game, turn it off, come back to it, it doesn't, like, reset the settings.
Oh, yeah.
But, yeah, all, like, rigs, basically every game I've played
so far. Yeah, like, I want the comfort settings off for all games because I'm good.
Yeah. Like, I want there to be a setting that says, you know, hey, this is new to PSVR, safe, like, you know, if you're kind of queasy, stuff like that. So, like, safe mode, take all that off. Yeah. I'm fine. I can do this for
that'd
hours.
Because I enjoyed the game when I was playing it the first time, but I got, like, halfway through the thing before I realized that I could pause it and, like, turn off that setting. I was like, this is much better. Because the way the other one works is you control your character and you go into the next room and the camera doesn't move. You have to hit on the right D-pad and the camera will teleport.
Yeah, when it's real, I'm like, when it's real disjointed and stuff like that, that's when I start to feel sick. I mean, we did that with the Tomb Raider demo. Where once we turned a few settings off and realized how the movement works, it's like, okay, now this feels better once you take all the, I call them safeties, off. But yeah, like when it's real fragmented and you can only see like the narrow scope of vision, and like like fisheye view basically is what it feels like. But
so anyway, those are all the things I've been playing, mostly Kingdom Hearts. So I won't have that to talk about anymore until Kingdom Hearts 3 comes out. I know it's a bummer. But
yeah, so it will be missed sorely.
Let's move on to the news. Once again, kind of like last week, lots of little stories that are just kind of like...
lots of little quick hits.
This happened.
Yeah.
Cool.
I don't know. I kind of like weeks like that.
Yeah, I don't mind it. It makes the show shorter. It's not a two-hour
show.
That
too,
we gotta
but film. I don't know. Like, towards the end of the year... added or just naturally towards the end of the year, and then with Nintendo doing start of the year, it was like conference, event, conference. So it was just like it was a little too much because all this little stuff would slip through.
That's true. We just didn't do little stuff because it's like, oh, Nintendo's announcing a console, I guess.
Yeah.
Guess we got to talk about
that. Let me take 3 hours of this.
All right. So first news story, real quick one, Horizon. It's gone gold.
Mm-hmm.
It's done. Maybe more importantly, they let the press play it. They let them come in and play 4 hours of the game, basically. There's a bunch of rules for what they could and couldn't show, but they let them play 4 hours of the game. Pretty positive overall. reviews, previews, I guess, the big takeaway was the world is huge. Yeah. Like, way bigger than I think they've portrayed. It is Bioware-esque in that there's branching dialogue path or, you know,
yeah, paths and all that. Yeah, I mean, with games like that, Witcher, things like that, for the past few years, because you're looking at Inquisition and Witcher 3 there, like, it's hard not to replicate some of the aspects of that.
Down to the dead faces everybody has in the... They talk to you
that's more of a Bioware,
like they're
sure.
frozen. Well, but, they have that in this game, too. I think the main character looks great.
The other big one, too, is not only those massive worlds, but it all feels like each piece is necessary for something. So a story will take you here, but there's something important over here, and it's, I think we're kind of getting away from sandbox games where it's just like, oh, I'm going to go over here to collect 10 chickens and that's it.
Yeah.
Like there's actually going to be something over there. So, but I do like this wave of this game's gone gold. This game, like, I don't know.
I love those announcements. Yeah, they're great.
I still,
this game's real. It exists.
Yeah. It feels like there was about a 4 or 5 year lull where they didn't do that anymore. Like towards the end of 360 and the start of this new generation, like they just didn't do it anymore. Because then it would just kind of show up and you wouldn't hear about it. But
yeah.
I like this announcement.
I do too.
Or those types of announcements. Also, like how I still don't know a lot about the game.
Yeah, so this is a weird game for me to talk about just because I'm still not sold in the way that I'm going to get it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm sold enough that I stopped watching story trailers. I don't want to know much about the game.
Yeah.
I listened to the early impressions, but like I don't want to know anything about the story, which...
Well, it feels too like they're not overloading people with... Like, Mass Effect's already hit the point now where it's just like, okay, we'll let you hype. And a couple other games...
Yeah, Mass Effect is a IP that already exists. Horizon, they need to at least knock on people.
I think it might have been, you know, after No Man's Sky last year, they're not... Yeah, we'll let press play it, but even the press, I think, part of it is saying, okay, we're not going to say, oh, here's the next GTA killer or something like that. Or they're not going to throw Mass Effect, Dragon Age, Witcher, stuff like that out there when they're talking about this game as much. I mean, maybe like branching dialogue or something for sure, but they're not hyping it like crazy.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like I would notice my YouTube or something blowing up if they put story trailer after story trailer after story trailer and all that.
So they did a couple of them.
Keeping quiet, basically.
Passing.
I like that when games kind of coast, like this is obviously the month it's coming out, so it's kind of coasting in, nice and quiet, few events it's maybe been to overseas or something like that, it's gone gold, and it's going to release. Perfect. Yeah.
And then nice, it's landing. Best when that, when then it releases and it's good.
Yeah.
The example I think about is Until Dawn. Like that game, it was like quiet, and Sony didn't even really talk about it and whatever, and it went gold, and that game was great. Yeah. But nobody even knew. Sony ran out of copies in stores because I don't think they realized.
The bottom end of that with like Tokyo Mirage last year was just like,
we're not even going to talk about
this. This is coming out. Like, and then like you forget about it and it's out. I was like, oh yeah. And then for people like me, it's game of the year. So
I will say the story, definitely the point people are most on, which surprises me because I am interested in the story, but if the game is that big, 4 hours may not be enough to get into it. I don't know. But I'm definitely, we will have this in our circulation here. So we will at least get to it. Yeah, Kellen's,
I think Kellen's got the big massive version.
Which looks beautiful. They did an unboxing and it is really pretty.
Did
but
they? Okay.
The devs did it. So I don't trust that that's the final one. And that's not like.
They're just throwing stuff in the box.
That's not like the. You know how when they go to shows, they'll bring like statues or whatever, and they're like gorgeous, and you're like,
yeah,
oh my
like
gosh,
press kits.
And then you pre-order it, and you're like, ah, this doesn't look anything like that one, but whatever.
Like high definition cameras, like showing off all
this
gleam
and
stuff.
Yeah, they're like, this is what we're targeting. It's like, oh, okay, we'll see how much you miss that mark. Next little piece of news, Final Fantasy XII, Zodiac Age, which is the HD version of Final Fantasy XII that they kind of quietly announced last year, I believe. It was at a concert, the... whoever does the music for it, I don't know, said on stage that he's excited that they're bringing back Final Fantasy 12, and I think they said 15 because that was getting ported to PS4 at the time, something like that. And everybody was like, Final Fantasy 12, and then he tweeted out, he's like, I misspoke, and then a week later, they're like, Final Fantasy 12's real. We're not showing you it, though. They never really put out much as far as trailers.
I don't hear
stuff,
12
but.
Get talked about a lot in Final
so
Fantasy
12's
circles.
A little bit of a black sheep. It's the... Some people swear by it, with all Final Fantasy. Some people swear by it. Some people don't like it at all. It stars probably the most, like, I don't know. You're like a shirtless 13-year-old boy or something. I don't know. I haven't
played
it. My
favorite.
Yeah, and it takes place in the desert. But I think the reason that they're doing this one now is because it's got real-time combat. It's the most similar to 15 out of all of
them.
Fair enough. I think the combat system, as it was explained to me, is the coolest thing ever. Mm-hmm. I don't know because I haven't played it. I'm getting this. But basically, the combat system is your party is built with code, basically. So it's a bunch of if this happens, then do this situations.
Okay, that's sort of like the original Dragon Age. There was a thing where if you choose this enemy, if this type of enemy shows up, do this.
Okay.
If this attack is sort of used, do this. If this person is inflicted with this, do this. So I like
from
that.
My understanding, that's how the combat like of that. Your party works.
Yeah.
And you find those things. So like you can open a chest and get an if this, then do that.
Oh, that's cool.
And then equip it that's to that person. Cool. So
yeah, I like that.
That's how I understand it. If that's completely wrong, I'm sorry. But July 12th, I'll figure it out.
I like micromanaging, but not to that degree. I like to have me being the competent team leader and then people around me because I've already spent the time setting up if this then that sort of commands. So yeah, that seems pretty cool.
Yeah, I'm very interested in trying that one out. So let's keep with small stories. So the next one, Resident Evil 7, mm-hmm. game that came out, people liked it, pretty good reviews. I was comparing people's reviews to, like, their website's reviews to this one because a lot of people were like, oh, this is the revive of Resident Evil 7. Mm-hmm. And I'd be like, all right. And I'd go look up their website's review for 6. And I'm like, you gave it lower review than 6, but sure. But anyway, the news that came out of this one is that 10% of PlayStation gamers played it in VR, which is a lot. Like, the game sold 2.5 million copies. I don't know how many of that was on PlayStation. But 10% is a bigger number than I thought people would play in VR for sure. And then speaking of the sales, they shipped 2.5 million, which Resident Evil 6 sold 5 to 6 million, and Resident Evil 5 sold 7 million.
Is that just PS4?
No, that's overall.
Oh, they're counting Steam and stuff like that, too?
Yeah. Okay. So that's not great. Comparative, they're disappointed by the basically just like Tomb Raider, where they sold like 4 million copies, and they're like, we're disappointed by our sales. They are disappointed by their Resident Evil sales because I guess they thought that this was going to be, you know, their revive, and they were going to sell more than 6, which I guess is, you know, but
I don't know. Like, I think I said it when we first noticed this article pop up earlier in the week, but I'll repeat it here. I think they just advertised it wrong from a numbers perspective. I think because I don't want to get too far into the game, like talking about it, because I know you said you're going to get to it as well.
Mm-hmm.
It is not 100% spooky, scary, creeping through halls. Like it goes like in waves, I guess is a easier way to say it. But they could have shown a lot more things, especially like those 30-second videos they kept hitting at. Before the release, where it's like, you can use herbs now, and then you can use guns, and like, oh, here's this type of gun, here's that type of gun, here's safe rooms. Like,
they could have expanded more on those things.
They could have shown that, and I think that would have bumped the numbers up a little bit. Whereas this one was purely marketed towards, like, oh, creepy family, you're sitting there and you're going to get limbs cut off. And then all the demos were, you know, really scary. So, I mean, you saw my reaction through the, I guess, arc of Resident Evil 7 where it was first announced. I was like, oh, okay, this is pretty cool, I guess. More demos came out. I was like, nope, never playing that. And then once I knew about these other parts and then these past 2 weeks where I've seen at least 2 full playthroughs of it now, yeah, I would play that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, to see me do a complete 180, like, yeah, give me a VR headset and give me the game. I'll play it right now. To see me go from that, like, I think that would have helped the numbers out a lot more.
I think they tried a new market, not new, but they tried Star Wars marketing, which was, we're not going to show you anything and we're going to write off our name.
Yeah, they had a lot of, like, red herrings and stuff like that,
I do think their name has gone up from this game. Like, I respect Resident Evil more than I did, and I think that might be enough for Resident Evil 8 when 8 inevitably comes out. I think that the boost in the positive talking about Resident Evil, as opposed to, like, we went to Video Games Live and they started playing Resident Evil. I was like, oh, God, why is this action music being played, you know?
Well, the other good part of that, now that you mentioned action, is that they're done with the movies now, too. So Resident Evil's name can, you know, go back up a little bit.
So only positive news, I think, that's enough to justify the game. It's going to do more overtime, obviously. Yeah. And then I think Resident Evil 8 will do better because
that
of this.
Week one DLC is pretty sketchy, too, as far as them putting out DLC this soon.
Yeah, that was, and it was like, I don't know, PlayStation has it for a month earlier, too, which just feels wrong. Like,
it's weird. It's more like a horde mode. Not really. I don't, it's a weird alternative mode that's on there right now, so I don't know. I think it was just marketed interestingly. Like, they got the people who are already going to play Resident Evil, but they didn't get the people who weren't going to play Resident Evil.
Yeah.
With all
that's what they tried with 6 and 5, and they did it.
Yeah.
But then the people who liked Resident Evil hated them afterwards.
So, yeah, I get that it's a bit of a damned if you do, damned if you don't sort of situation. Kind of. But
I would prefer them make smaller games like this, contained, actually, you know, horror games.
I think the Resident Evil fans like it, or at least bits and pieces of it.
They definitely like it.
People who are just like, oh, okay, it's a scary game, like it. Other people who are just like, I've got VR, or I want to play, you know, the first big game of the year, like it. I mean, they got 80s up into the 90s, stuff like that. So, I mean, it was reviewed well, but all they had to do was just market it towards the new people.
I agree.
Keep everything the same. Or just have the scary demo for the Resident Evil people. Have something along the lines of this alternative mode DLC for like a demo, so people can be like, oh, okay, so there's this kind of element of it too. Because in VR, you're using like your head to aim and shoot and stuff like that. So they could have done a second demo or marketed it differently, but I think that would have bumped it up to maybe 3. But I'm no, expert.
Yeah, we'll see what happens with the Resident Evil name after this. Next, we'll talk about the Deus Ex name. So basically, what's the company that makes Deus Ex?
Eidos Montreal.
Yeah. So they're working on the Avengers.
Yeah, this
game
is piggybacking off of last week's.
They also do Tomb Raider. They're also working on the new Tomb Raider game. And Deus Ex, what was the new one?
See, this Mankind Divided.
Mankind Divided was the new one. Didn't sell well, like, at all.
Yeah, it just, yeah. There's.
It was reviewed well, did very, like, very bad. So they are like, we're done with Deus Ex. I know that they had planned like 4 or 5 more Deus Ex games already,
really,
like, ready to go, and not ready to go, but planned story wise. Yeah, yeah. And they are putting all that on hold, probably because A, Avengers and such will make them more money, and B, it just didn't sell. It didn't do what they thought it would. So basically, the news in this is, I know that that one ended on like a cliffhanger. It was kind of like, there's definitely more to this, the most recent one.
Yeah.
We may not actually figure out what that is. So, not a huge day. You're the Deus Ex person who's played
it. Yeah,
so.
This, I mean, that was, I didn't really mention it in like the Game of the Year talks and too much because I didn't really have the time to sit there and knock it. It ended abruptly.
Yeah, that's what I've heard.
It, not only a cliffhanger, but it was just like, and you're walking in over, and it's like, whoa, okay. Like, there was no build up. So, I mean, it's a perfect second game because you don't really need the long, drawn out cliffhanger for middle of a trilogy. I mean, look at Lord of the Rings and stuff like that for examples of, you know, how you end a second movie. But, yeah, I don't know. It just ended abruptly. And yeah, it makes sense. This announcement makes sense for them because, like you said, they're going to make tons of money.
They'll be fine. I think Deus Ex fans might not be.
Yeah, Deus Ex is better when there's like 5, 6, 7 years in between each one, even if it is part of an ongoing like storyline. Give it some time. Like, it's one of those like fine wine sort of games where you want to let it mature over a while, like give it sort of like the Final Fantasy treatment where you take close to a decade to finish it and make it more of like a masterpiece rather than like, we got to make a new one. So
Next up, pretty quick, Psychonauts in the Rhombus of Ruin is coming February 21st. This is their VR Psychonauts. It's Psychonauts 1.5. Takes place in between 1 and 2.
Mm-hmm.
You're jumping through into like the minds of different characters, and you're playing around in there. I don't exactly know how that works, but
mm-hmm.
February 21st, VR. Interested in that. I will probably be getting and checking that out. This was pretty big. So first, Battlefront 2 single player campaign. We assumed that.
Yeah.
Whatever. Not too much to say on that, just because we assumed that. Bigger news, BioWare, new IP coming,
mm-hmm.
2018. And there was a quote, basically, had a lot of people worried, we'll see. But basically it says the game will have new concepts, new gameplay mechanics, and new stories set in a unique new universe. This game's very new. The game will have... the game has the potential to fundamentally disrupt the way people think about an action title.
Mm-hmm.
An action. So it's not... It's going to be an action game.
Yeah.
Bringing friends together to play in exhilarating new ways. New. We're very excited for the future of this franchise. Blah, 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 blah. So we're getting a, I assume, hardcore action title from BioWare.
I've heard this one called the Destiny Killer, potentially. Because, like, if you could imagine all the knocks against Destiny, at least before all these big expansions hit, because mm-hmm. I don't know the state of the game now, I'm assuming it's a lot better. Took it from, like, maybe a D to a B, in my mind, with
it has a story. It has a story now, I guess.
Yeah. Like, if you put that sort of concept in the hands of storytelling masters, you know, that BioWare kind of seems to be, you gotta wonder, like, I mean, none of that says first person, none of it says shooter, blah, 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 like, but you gotta wonder, like, if they put this sort of Destiny system in BioWare's hands, what that game would have turned out to be versus mm-hmm. Bungie, which is kind of weird to say that.
I feel like it would have turned out an MMO. That's what it feels like to me. And I still stand, I think Destiny should have just been, hey, we're a first person shooter MMO.
Yeah.
I would.
But this makes sense. Obviously, they're shipping out Andromeda in March.
Mm-hmm.
They already said in 2015 when Inquisition came out, Dragon Age Inquisition, that they were going to take some time between it. So this feels like the perfect kind of gap filler. It's either doing something like this or going back in their vault of games and doing like a Jade Empire 2. But I think they're kind of, I think they would want to test the waters with Mass Effect to see if they, you know, if we still got it sort of thing, if people are still going to like what we do, and if we can still make these super highly rated games. So they're doing that, and then now with this one, it was either, like I said, go back and drag up something from the grave, or do a new IP.
Yeah, I think they're just tired of doing RPGs, to be honest. I think they've done all they can do. Every game that they make, the next one has more and more like actiony stuff in it.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like they're pushing towards doing this anyway,
and they can do.
They've finally been like, let's just make an action game. Yeah. Like what we want to do.
Yeah, because they've gone all the way from one end of the scale to like Never Winter Nights and stuff like that, which is just literally like text based and classic RPG, all the way up to these games now, Inquisition or Andromeda, where it's got a ton of action in it, and they're not
Andromeda just looks like a straight up action game,
and it's not bad action either, so they know they can do it well. But yeah, if they cut off some of the RPG elements of it, maybe save that for like weapons and stuff like that, loadouts and things like that, sort of
basically Destiny.
But if they make like an action based like loot game, basically like maybe a Diablo or a Destiny or something like that, sure, go for it.
I'm interested.
They can still, they don't need the RPG elements to tell a story. And I think that's probably where they're going with that.
Next up, PlayStation Plus. They reveal their game always right after we do our podcast, because that's how that goes. It's always like the Wednesday after we do our podcast for the month. But anyway, we have kind of a big month. Little Big Planet 3 as a PS4 game, which I think is their AAA game's first one since, like, I don't know, they gave out Injustice a long time ago. But I can't think of many, like, giant titles that they get. Like, Outlast was big and stuff, but that's not, like, a retail release, like, a big thing.
The last one in my mind was Resident Evil Remaster, but that wasn't exactly like booming. That was just kind of a big name from the past.
That was awesome.
Yeah.
But anyway, Little Big Planet 3, Not a Hero, Starwall, Anna, Ninja Senkai DX, and Torque L. The only one I know, Anna is a horror, like, first-person horror game, PS3.
Fun.
But Little Big Planet 3 I enjoyed. I got that when it came out. I went through it. I beat it. Mm. Definitely worth playing for free. And that's also cool because it's such an online game.
Mm-hmm. It might revive it a little bit.
The more people that are in it at once, the better. So giving that away is awesome. Let's talk about GameStop. We always have so many nice things to say about GameStop. Let's just keep that train.
I'm fine with it now because I never go there. That train anymore. Going.
GameStop's a bunch of liars. Basically, the story came out that GameStop employees have been told to lie to their customers about stock prices.
Mm-hmm.
Not stock, but inventory.
Yeah.
If you go into GameStop and you ask for something new, they might just lie to you and be like, we don't have it, even though they have four of them, so that you buy the pre-owned copy.
Basically,
they'll lie to you about their inventory numbers to push the pre-owned copy because they make way, 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 way more money mm-hmm. on pre-owned than new things. And if they have some sort of sale going on or something like that, they won't tell you about it if it's on new things.
Mm-hmm.
And this has been advocated by multiple, like, GameStop managers and stuff have come out and confirmed that this is happening. I've read a whole bunch of this shady stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I know that they're allowed to take their new games and go home and play them and then bring them back. That's why when you buy games from them, they aren't even sealed. Like, they open their games.
Yeah.
GameStop's super sketchy. I rarely buy from them, and the only time I do, which is something that we're going to talk about, is, like, a pre-order bonus
mm-hmm.
or something like that. But now with Amazon Prime and Gamers Club Unlocked making the prices even cheaper, because GameStop doesn't have that, I buy from GameStop.
And delivering right to your door.
Yeah, I buy from GameStop literally only if they're sold out everywhere else.
Yeah. I don't know. Not a big fan. I've never really enjoyed much of the staff that's been in there, and I know that's
I know so many people that have worked at GameStop, though.
Yeah, I do, too, but, like, I don't know. I catch all the bad ones, it seems like. Yeah, the staff there, and I've never just been really impressed with the storefront itself.
I hate it now. Now it's like going into a kid's room. You've got to, like, shimmy past all the stuff. There's no room to walk around. Like, oh,
there's always a TV blaring with stupid ads and stuff with their own, like, network that they have on there. It's just like, I don't know. It's loud. There's always tons of people in there. Yeah. I don't know. I just prefer online. I don't like people enough to do that.
Injustice 2, we've been talking about and will continue to talk about up until its release.
Yeah, it's just trickling out.
They have a lot of, I think I counted, they have a website up with their characters. There's 20 empty spaces still.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a lot of characters that they still have
to
reveal.
It's like mini Smash.
Yeah, I think every week we're probably going to get one now.
Yeah.
But they revealed Black Canary.
Mm-hmm.
Not super surprising. She won the poll for, they did a poll. Who do you want to see? She won. She's like the second most popular female DC character next to Wonder Woman. She's the most popular couple in Black Canary, Green Arrow. I really liked her trailer. A lot of people didn't. And I fully understand that because I didn't like it. I watched it twice. The first time I liked it, I watched it, I was like, eh. And then the second time I really liked it, and I don't know what the difference was. I just liked it a lot more.
This is something I didn't look beforehand.
I think it was just the shock of how they did the canary cry, which is basically her screaming sound waves. I was like, oh, that's weird. And then the second time I watched it, I knew that it was going to look like that. And I'm like, okay, I get it now. I liked her a lot more the second time.
Mm-hmm.
I like her design. I think she looks really good. They did reveal Bane, who I don't like his design of. And they revealed Poison Ivy, who I also don't like her design of, which sucks. But they always have skins and stuff, so I don't really care that much. It's not that big of a deal.
Yeah, with that type of stuff, I always wish that they would do, like, here's the Batman and Robin skin. Here's the Nolan series skin.
Just show
skin.
Them from the start.
I don't know. Like, they get 30 seconds to a minute of them fighting usually in these types of trailers.
Like, oh, just showed the different skins during that. Yeah, I agree. That'd
like,
be awesome.
Like, show the default skin walking up, doing the little conversation thing, whatever, and then, you know, maybe show a combo or two, flip to the next skin. Sort of like they did with, they did that at the beginning, right? The first couple, like Harley Quinn and a couple other skins.
It Harley Quinn, when she was walking out, they flashed different skins. Yeah. Yeah, that was cool.
Yeah, do that. Yeah, I don't know why they stopped doing that.
Yeah, that would have been nice, actually.
But yeah, like, I want to know that going in because
I think they did it with Harley Quinn because people are so defensive about her blue and pink hair change. Mm-hmm. People are like, I need the original costume. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So. Another thing that I do want to point out is we went over 2 weeks ago or so, all the leaked characters, Black Canary on that list. So we're still spot on for those leaks.
Yeah. Those guys that tend to leak, the Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite, Street Fighter, like those guys are usually on top of their game.
Yeah. I still think that it's perfectly, true. Mm-hmm. And I'm excited because Scarecrow being in that game is so awesome to me.
But also when you have 40 character slots, it's pretty easy to just be like, who are the most popular DC characters?
That's true. Now there's some weird ones like Dr. Fate's on that list and stuff. If he gets revealed, I believe the list completely. Mm-hmm. So, next up, Hellblade, which is a exclusive PC/PS4 game. It's done by Ninja Theory, who did Heavenly Sword.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In comparison. Lots of people think that the character is the same. She looks the same. She kind of has the same name. She has the same personality traits, but they swear it's not her.
Just having a bad day.
I'm a little confused. Anyway, somebody tweeted, I'm so excited for your game. Are we playing it this year? And they tweeted back and they're like, yep, it's coming in 2017. So not a whole lot of news on it. We haven't seen that much of the game. They have these developer diaries that you can go and watch, but like Sony is not like, hey, here's this game, which I think is interesting because they're normally at least okay with pushing their exclusives. But yeah, I'm super excited about this game whenever it decides to come out.
Keep that one on the list for E3, then I'm sure it'll show up.
With a release date, probably.
Well, with actual like footage of the game and like here's like a complete look at it.
Yeah, we haven't seen much. Like we just kind of started learning what the gameplay is and where the camera sits. It's very, of course, Last of Us.
Yeah, back in the day when we were talking about some of this stuff,
everything is
going gold announcements, demos, and my third one was Dev Diaries. Mm-hmm. I love Dev Diaries.
Yeah, they have plenty of those for that game. So if you're interested in it, you can. I assume it's Ninja Theory's YouTube channel, but they have multiple ones that you can go check out. Next, and lots of PS4 news. Next up, and the last one on our news list, is PS4's getting a new firmware. This is a beta that right now, but we know what's going to be in it. Some things people have been asking for a lot. First off, simpler notifications. Basically, instead of having downloads and uploads and alerts and friend invitation, it's just all going to be on one. It's all going to be on one list, which makes perfect sense. You can make custom themes now, which basically lets you take your screenshots in game and post them as backgrounds. And then I believe you can change it so, like, if you scroll up to like your friends list, you can make it so the background changes, things like that. They also allow you to kind of tint where the bar would be so that if your background's very bright, the logos won't all fade into it, which is nice. More exciting, 3D Blu-ray support on PSVR. So you'll be able to watch 3D Blu-rays on PSVR. I'm interested to see how that works.
Yeah, I'm happy about the potential of that because I've got, whenever I buy like Blu-rays, movies, of course, usually I'll get the combo packages. So even though I've got standard high definition display on my screen, I don't have 4K, I don't have 3D. But if this will let me do 3D, that'd be pretty cool because I've already got a lot of movies that have it anyway.
I have a 3D TV, so I own a bunch as well, and I'm very interested to see how this looks. And then probably the biggest one, external hard drives are going to be accepted finally, which people have been asking for forever, up to 8 terabytes, which is plenty.
Yeah. So. That's literally the most annoying thing to me about the PS4 is, okay, I'm ready for this new game, because as you already noted, a lot of these big hitters early on this year are console exclusive.
Yeah.
Or
you don't have enough memory. You got to uninstall a game.
Yeah,
and like, then you uninstall it. It's like, you still don't have enough memory. Yeah. Pick another game, buddy.
And people like you who don't want to delete certain things off your hard drive. So,
gosh, man, I would have such a beefed up hard drive if PT didn't exist. So let's move on to some viewer questions. So first one, who are some of our favorite underrated gaming YouTubers/streamers? So we're talking Twitch, YouTube, things like that. All of mine happen to be YouTube content creators. I'm not giant into the amount of Twitch streamers I watch, I can count on one finger. So it's, you know, nothing against them. I just don't really like watching Let's Play gameplay too much. But
well, Twitch and stuff like that's really diluted now. Maybe a few years ago there were a lot less people, so a lot more unique, but there's so many people that stream now. It's hard to wade through all of it, but you had three?
Yeah, I've got so two.
Okay, you start then.
I'll start off. My first one is Super Butterbuns. She has 80K subs, which she's been... she had 40K pretty recently. She's been on an uptick, which is really awesome. Mm-hmm. I really like her... Basically, her ability to explain in a coherent thought what is going on mm-hmm. with her thoughts on the game. Specifically, I actually brought her up before on the show. Specifically, like Final Fantasy 13, and she likes all the anime games. Final Fantasy 13 and Kingdom Hearts and things. She's able to be like, okay, this is how I feel about the game. This is why. And articulate it in a way that I'm like, yes, I completely agree. But when I try to explain that, mm-hmm. it just doesn't come out right. And it's a big mess. She also has, and her most popular videos are for beginners, which basically highlight, hey, are you starting this game? Here's some things you should know before going in. And I think I found her from her Persona 3 or 4 video. Mm-hmm. My sister got it, and I had already beaten it at that point. So I watched it, made sure it wasn't like super spoilery or anything. I'm like, hey, you should watch this video because the game can get really frustrating if you don't know what's going on. So I really like her channel. She does that. She does Thoughts On, which is basically just, hey, Persona 5 is delayed again. Let me scream at the computer for a while. And then she also does these Do You Remember series that are pretty interesting if you actually remember the game, where mm-hmm. she's just like, here's a game you've probably saw on the store shelf and never bought.
Yeah.
Let me tell you about it. So
my first one, his name's Marcus, but I think his username is Epic Name Bro. I know. He is big into the Souls games, and why I like him is because as he's playing, he's really good at, sort of like you said, talking through his thoughts and saying, okay, I'm going to do this because, I'm going to do this because, but it feels like a walkthrough when you're going. So I know he plays and talks at the same time, but it's one of those where it feels like, man, did he just record this and then go back afterwards and record his thoughts? Like, he's just real smooth like that. Obviously, those games aren't... They're pretty action heavy every now and then, but it's a lot calmer. It's one or two enemies at a time. It's never like a Dynasty Warriors game where there's 100 guys on screen. You're like, oh God, oh God. And it's not fast paced. So you can collect your thoughts and you can be a lot more deliberate in the way you talk. But a big thing that he goes through is he pieces together the lore of those games. And if you've ever heard me talk about it, it's not like a narrator pops up and says, in the year, blah, 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 this happened. It's like, okay, I just picked up this new weapon. You go to your inventory, and it tells you about the weapon. It gives you a description. Right. This was so-and-so's sword from this. This happened. And that's how you piece together, like, the story or the plot is through items and drops and pieces of paper and things like that. So he goes through and connects all those dots for you as he's playing. So like, not only are you seeing, okay, this is a cool game, maybe I wouldn't play it, you know, whatever, but he tells you all this stuff and just like, it makes a game that just looks like, oh, this is just a difficult game just to be difficult, and he turns it into more of like a narrative. So that's really cool.
That is cool.
And I'm glad he does that, and there's people like him, because before I bought the 300 page like Prima guides basically for it, you know, that's where I would go to, YouTube videos. And he's not, thank God, he's not one of those people who, you know, if it's saying Dark Souls 3 walkthrough video 4, it's not like, hey, welcome back. And, you know, it's not personality. He's got a personality, but he's a lot more chill, relaxed.
Yeah, I prefer, like, the only Let's Plays and things that mm-hmm. I'll watch are speedruns and people who know the game inside and out and enough to talk about it and be like, yeah, the developer here really wanted to do this, but they couldn't, and I'm like, oh, that's interesting.
And where he comes from with all this knowledge is that he wrote a lot of the guides for the Souls games, so he was part of the team that put together those guides, so he has a lot of... not just knowledge about the game, but like the Japanese developers and stuff like that. Like, he's had conversations with them. So, and he used to live out there for a little bit. So he brings a lot more to a seemingly stale narrative. Because like, if you're just watching someone play it, you're watching someone get pissed because they've died 5 times. And, you know, you're just seeing cool weapons and cool creatures and stuff like that. But watching his makes it feel like, oh, okay, I'm learning something about this game, where the other hundreds of people who stream Souls games wouldn't give you that. So pretty cool.
My next one is Mystic, which is a deceptive name. Basically, he does a very PlayStation-focused channel. Mm-hmm. He has a show every week called Let's Talk PlayStation, where he just does PlayStation news. And then the other shows on his channel are things like, his name's Ryan Benecki. Some other things on the channel are Ryan On. So Ryan On Gaming, and it'll be like, oh, DLC. And he'll just do a 10-minute video talking about his thoughts on DLC or mm-hmm. things like that. But lots of the people, actually everybody on this list, it's just people that I enjoy listening to their opinions on mm-hmm. Things, and they're good at articulating themselves. Unlike myself. So, I really like his videos. And then he's actually one of the reasons I started a YouTube channel. I have about three people that I watch that I was like, man, I really want to do this. Mm-hmm. And he is one of them just because, you know, he's just in his room talking to his camera with his PlayStation in the background. But he was doing the news. And I was like, you know, I want to do that. And that was a big influence for me starting the PressX News, which evolved into this horrendous podcast.
Well, here's to him then. My second one and final one is, his name's Aris. He is part of the fighting game community. He's one of the people who commentates and stuff like that, goes to all the major events. He's more on the Tekken side of things. People mm-hmm. in those camps, I guess in the fighting game camps, usually have their base game and then sort of games that are similar to it. And, you know, they kind of stick to that region. Oh, I know Street Fighter, but screw Tekken, screw Smash.
Yeah, they have their I was eliminated. Let me go play this other game.
And then for things like Evo and things like that, where they have a rotation of games, if Smash is coming up, they have 2, 3, 4 guys who are coming on. They know Smash. They've been there since the dawn of time. And like I said, he's a Tekken player. He used to be really high up in the Soul Calibur 2, I think, ladders, won tournaments and stuff like that. So a little bit more old school. I call him Future Kellen. He's a chubby guy, big beard, stuff like that. And I don't know. It just reminds me a lot of Kellen. But this guy is based out of West Coast, so he's always in those fighting game tournaments up and down that coast. But, his name is Avoiding the Puddle. That name comes from a move in Tekken.
Gosh, your names are a lot better than mine.
It's from an old move in Tekken. But what he typically streams, he does Souls games as well. This guy is just 100% personality. But I've seen him in all these tournaments and videos and stuff like that, so I know it's legitimate and it's not just like an on-screen personality.
Gotcha.
A very interesting guy. Like, he just is one of those people that, like, everything you says, you find yourself kind of cracking up over. It's just like pure comedy. Not the greatest at video games. So this is the guy I watch play Resident Evil 7.
Yes.
This is the guy I watch play Souls games. Challenging games get the better of him. And, you know, he's freaking out or he's getting killed and like, oh, this sucks, you know, something like that. So it's one of the more comedic routes, that I usually take with streams. Sometimes you just want to see like the best guys play.
Yeah.
You want to see the guy go 20-0 in Call of Duty or something like that. That's not him. Very sarcastic, kind of back and forth with Twitch chat, which is always fun because people either ignore Twitch chat. If they're girls, you know, it's a lot worse as far as like what people are saying to you. But a lot of people either interact really bad or really well with chat. He's one of the really well ones because, like, he'll see someone saying something stupid, kick him out. someone else, you know, makes a joke, he'll just, like, pick on people and stuff like that. It's really
funny.
It just
sounds like Future Kellen.
It feels like there's actual, like, a community there, whereas some people are just like, oh, thanks for the $5. Oh, thanks for the $5.
Gotcha.
You know, or whatever with streams. So it's a little bit different. I think he tends to float in the 2,000 to 3,000 viewer range. So that's kind of where I like it. When you get up to the 20,000, that's when you have to turn Twitch chat off. Like
there's
a constant stream of stuff going on. Just like I said, pure comedy and entertainment versus my other guy, which is a lot more informative. You don't have the volume cranked all the way up. Like, it's just like, okay, I want to learn basically about this game. Whereas this guy is just like, I'm doing something else, but I want to see this idiot, get crushed by a game or something like that, or really just struggle with this part and get some humor out of it.
My last one, real small, 3K subs. I guess I should say Mystica 75K. 3K subs on YouTube. Also, I believe on iTunes, but I don't have iTunes because I hate Apple. The Game Blitz podcast. This is some people who watch Metal Jesus may know Kelsey from his videos. She has a gaming podcast with Cody. It's very similar to this. Mm-hmm. Just two people talking about video games, but she's very knowledgeable about video game history.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of where, so she'll be like, hey, this is the history of Nintendo or Kirby or whatever she wants to tell you about. And
she's,
you
know, the scholar of video
games. Yeah, and she owns a video game store, so she knows prices. She can talk retro games, she can talk new games.
She doesn't lie to you to sell pre-owned games.
Yeah. So just very, once again, informative podcast. I like it a whole lot, and definitely, I don't know what their numbers are like on iTunes or any other podcast services, but as far as YouTube goes, definitely should have more viewers. So if you like our stuff for whatever reason, you should definitely like their stuff for sure, because very similar, except they're not idiots.
Speak for yourself.
So let's move on to our next question, which I briefly brought up earlier, which is pre-order bonuses. Do you think pre-order bonuses are bad for the industry? Yeah. very much so.
I mean, nowadays, you're not going to find many people who are just like, yeah, pre-order bonus. It's more just like, I guess I have to do this.
Yeah, it feels dirty. It feels like you're being locked into something against your will, to be honest. I absolutely hate it. I've multiple times pre-ordered games at different places because the game might be cheaper here, but I don't get the pre-order bonus here. And then I have to return the other one and all this stuff.
I think No Man's Sky, not because of anything on its part, but the hype that it had to try and live up to but didn't, made pre-order, not just pre-order bonus, but just pre-order in general, a taboo word for the next couple of years.
Well, there was, I think it was Deus Ex, actually, something had that pre-order, when we get 100,000 pre-orders, we'll unlock this, and like the more people that pre-ordered, the more stuff you get, and like the earliest, like the last one was like, get the game 2 weeks early,
it was,
and
like,
I'm like, okay, guys.
A pre-order Kickstarter.
Yeah, it was the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen, and like the worst one that we've talked about last week was, I believe it was last week, we were talking about, oh, if you pre-order here, you get this car, and if you pre-order here, you get that car, and if you pre-order here, I hate that stuff, especially when they don't sell them separately. Mm-hmm. I know I talked about the Mass Effect DLC for,
even if they do
13
sell
2,
it separately,
like,
you still have to pay for it.
It's horrible. And the another big one was PlayStation All-Stars. You got 20 DLC costumes if you pre-ordered. So if you didn't pre-order, A, it took a year for those to come out on like PSN, and B, they were like $4 for four costumes. They're basically a dollar each. Gravity Rush had a similar thing. The soundtrack, I think, is $11.99.
Mm-hmm.
And if you pre-ordered, you get the soundtrack for free and a costume. And I'm like, this is ridiculous. Like, I hate pre-order bonuses. I hate pre-ordering in general. And I would never do it, except I'm a sucker for the pre-order. I hate the worst feeling ever. Like, it feels good if you don't pre-order and you're like, I don't care. But the worst feeling ever is discovering a game later and then realizing there's something in the game you can't have because you didn't pre-order it.
One of the worst ones was, I think it was Dragon Age 2. It had access to an area where you could buy special items. They called it like the Black Emporium or something. But you would go in and there was a few treasure chests and a few vendors. And you could buy really powerful items for certain levels. Like, those kind of games have, I guess, blocks in like your power level where, you know, once you hit this point, there's like a decay in the power level for this item. So you switch to the next best thing. So you go through that three or four times, but that store had all of those. But if you didn't pre-order, you didn't get access to it for a while or something like that. I don't know. Like, any type of thing that cuts you off from a system sucks. It's the worst. Any type of skins, anything like that, because like you said, I think Street Fighter,
I think all the skins should be, hey, if you pre-order, you get it in a month, they're free.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you get it early. Like, that would be fine as long as free.
Or even
is
if
the,
it was just like
the final
they
price.
Get access to this skin, but you get the shiny gold version or the one that's on fire or, you know, something like that, like a cool addition to it. Like, that's fine. That's worth me spending the extra $5 or something stupid on, I guess. But, like, I don't know. I don't like pre-ordering anymore. The only reason I can stand it is because Amazon doesn't charge you until
it actually ships. You have enough time to see the reviews typically, yeah, and such.
But that's the other bad half of pre-ordering. And I know we're talking more about bonuses, I guess, mm-hmm. but it's still the whole concept of pre-ordering is nowadays, like, everything from double A to triple A titles is on all these blocks, or basically sites can't review it or even like really talk about it until week of,
and by then the embargoes, yeah,
it's like by then it's too late for the most part.
I mean, that's how they get people pre-ordering.
Yeah,
like for I had a friend who had The Last Guardian for PS3 pre-ordered, mm-hmm. and they canceled it last year. Mm-hmm. Like, he pre-ordered that forever ago, and you can pre-order, like, Kellen pre-ordered Detroit. That game might not come out for another 2 years. Yeah. Like, we have no clue.
I like the idea of pre-ordering different versions. Like, if you're getting the deluxe version or the high-end version, sure, because, I mean, that's going to be a limited quantity. I wish they would do limited quantity, at least, and not release the game and then do more collector's editions after that. Like, I wish all of those blank edition...
were limited.
Yeah, we're limited, and I don't mind pre-ordering that because they need to make a certain number.
Yeah, I pre-order collectors.
Because it feels like you're kind of, you know, grabbing a ticket for it, and if the tickets are out, then you don't get one.
Right.
I get that one, and I like that one, and I'm a big fan of super versions of games and stuff like that. That's cool when you give people choices, I think. But I don't like... If you get this version from GameStop, you get this. If you get this version from Best Buy, you get that. Amazon's got this. Like, no. Like, stop.
The only other two that I want to point out real quick that I don't like. Resident Evil 7,
mm-hmm.
kind of bummed out about this one. If you pre-ordered it, you can start on the highest difficulty mode.
Otherwise,
you have to beat the game.
Yeah.
So that's literally, like, 10 hours of your life that mm-hmm. you would have saved if you pre-ordered it, which particularly sucks for someone like me who's a trophy whore and wants to platinum, mm-hmm. like at least have a shot at platinuming every game. And there's nothing more frustrating to me. I refuse to do it. If you make me beat your game and then beat it again on hard, like you have to unlock the difficulty and then play it again to platinum it, that drives me crazy. I won't do it. Like, I absolutely hate that. So the fact that you could get by that, and then they're just like, oh, if you pre-order it, you can get fine. I'm like, screw you.
Mass Effect 1 would have driven you nuts then, because there's 5 difficulties. The first playthrough, you can only do up to the 3rd difficulty. You have to unlock the 4th one, and then you have to unlock the 5th one.
Yeah, that's
one,
miserable. So. Uncharted did that too, and I was like, I'll play on easy and just ignore this.
But yeah, like, I don't know. Just past couple of years have really made pre-order, like, just the concept of it just kind of
horrible. Yeah, I hope it dies. The other one that I absolutely hate, which is Microsoft's model, which is if you pre-order our collector's edition, you get the game 4 days early. And I'm like, that sucks, especially for multiplayer games.
Well, I was getting ready to say,
drives me crazy,
that Origin / EA access.
Yeah, I hate
all that. And now preloading games and stuff like that.
Well, that's fine.
That's bringing it back up for me a little bit. I like the idea, because what Andromeda is doing, at least, because I know that one off the top of my head, is
shocking.
I know, right? So the Friday before it would come out, EA / Origin Access is going to allow people to play, or it might be the Thursday before, is going to allow people to play 10 hours of the story and then stop. But you get unlimited time playing the multiplayer of those games all the way through to Tuesday, and they said that one doesn't affect the other, blah, blah, blah. I love that. That's awesome.
See, I hate that. Like, why not just release the game that day?
I don't know, but I like it. Makes
like,
me feel,
I don't get it.
It makes me feel special, at least.
Yeah, see, it makes other people feel like crap. That's the problem. They need to come up with a pre-order bonus idea or pre-order idea that doesn't make people feel terrible. And yeah. I think the best way to do that is, hey, if you pre-order it, you're guaranteed to get the game the day that it comes out. Done. That's what a pre-order is supposed to be.
Yeah.
I didn't get Kingdom Hearts the day it came out. They even messed that one up. Thanks, mm-hmm. Best Buy.
Yeah, but that kind of scared me. That's why I'm ordering a few games this year from multiple outlets.
So I've never really had a problem with Best Buy, except I had a problem with 2.8 and Tomb Raider all in the past like 3 months, which is terrible because I've never had a problem with them before. So now I'm worried about my Persona 5 because I need that the day that comes out.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking about ordering Persona 5 elsewhere now.
Yeah, I'm worried about it too, because I'm actually like taking days off work and stuff like that for some of these games. So I don't want to just be sitting there like, where's my game?
Yeah.
Because then I'll have to go into GameStop and they're going to tell me that they don't have a new version.
I'm gonna have it used.
How do you have it pre-owned? It's day of release.
All right. Speaking of releases, let's move on to the releases. Gareth, as always, doing the write-up. Kellen not here today. Well, we'll be here soon probably, but not here right now. So
I had you to get learn, to... I had to learn how to read before this, so... All right,
we'll
here
see
we
how
go.
This goes.
Only one of these matter, but I'll read them anyway. February 6th, which is Tuesday?
I don't know, man.
Monday? It's got to be Monday if it's PC. Mobius Final Fantasy, PC. PC port of the Final Fantasy mobile game. Mobius Final Fantasy tells the story of a man who wakes up in a world called Palamessia with no memory of his past. There, he finds himself tasked with bringing hope to the world by unraveling a mysterious prophecy around the legendary Warrior of Light.
If they didn't play it on mobile, I don't think they're going to play it on PC.
That's a weird...
Go for it.
That's a weird jump from mobile to PC.
Yeah.
I can understand the other
route.
Yeah,
I can too.
Like,
that's
oh,
weird.
This was popular. Let's make it on mobile, but whatever. February 7th. This is Tuesday. Uncanny Valley for the PS4, PS Vita, and Xbox One. Uncanny Valley is a survival horror game that includes a mix of exploration, puzzle solving, and a bit of action with a lot of optional story content. The game tries to preserve the old survival horror kind of gameplay instead of following the modern trend of creating a third-person shooter with horror elements. This was a PC release in 2015.
Interesting.
Bad release timing to come this close to Resident Evil.
I say interesting, I'm not going to get it, but interesting.
Knights of Azure on PC. PC port of this PS4 release from last year. Knights of Azure is an RPG where characters fight alongside demons known as Servan. They can be summoned using the game mechanics and are broken down into various types. They also level up and become more powerful over the course of the game. All right. Atelier Sophie, the alchemist of the missing book, PC. Another PS4 to PC port. This is the 17th installment of the Atelier JRPG series that has been made.
Set against never the, heard of it.
I'm probably butchering the name of it too, but I've never seen that word before in my life. Set against a vibrant background reminiscent of medieval European town, this game follows the exploits of a young novice alchemist who discovers she is the owner of an enigmatic volume imbued with a soul. This mysterious book seems to hold all the secrets to alchemy knowledge, and it goes on to become Sophie's mentor. A book.
Okay.
Well, this one's Japanese. Tohu Genso Warrior for the PS4 and PS Vita. In this roguelike RPG, you will take control of Reimu, the Hakurei Shrine Maiden, to investigate the latest incident to take over the world of Gensokyo. Along the way, you will encounter a variety of characters from the Tohu Project universe, discover mountains of loot, each piece of which is valuable thanks to the game's item fusion system, and test your mettle with your favorite Tohu girl, Ento, as your adventuring partner in this approachable take on the roguelike genre.
Gareth could have literally just typed made up words for those things, and
thank
we would
you.
Never
I
know.
I think you did. I wanted to know about this favorite Tohu girl, though. I don't know. I've never heard of that either. 8 days for Xbox One and PS4. Join the mercenary forces of GOD Incorporated, where you get to play as one of two expendable soldiers, Mike or Lola. Fight against global nuclear threats, Middle East fighters, and city riots whilst traveling to the most dangerous places unimaginable.
All right.
Your favorite game, WWE 2K17 for the PC. As with every console WWE game released, the PC port follows about 4 months later. 2017 continues that trend. More of WWE wrestling action that you expect from 2K.
I haven't played one of those games in like 10 years, but yeah. They are fun.
Yeah.
At least 10 years ago.
Yeah, that's a once in every decade sort of genre. I just don't know anyone in wrestling anymore. So
yeah, that's true.
I don't recognize any of them. The big one, Neo for PS4. In Neo, players will traverse war-torn Japan as William, a blonde-haired swordsman whose background as a fierce warrior and seasoned knowledge of the blade allows him to survive in the demon-plagued land of the samurai. Known as yokai, these demons inhabit a number of dangerous locations and lie in wait in the shadows to ambush unsuspecting victims. Players will also face off with other samurai in supernatural sword battles and intense multi-target engagements, offering a level of difficulty that will truly test even the most hardened samurai's skills, patience, and strategy. Note from Gareth, this game makes him wish that he had a PS4.
Yeah, so just from what I've heard about this game from people that have it and everything, very good. It's getting great reviews.
Review scores are way higher than I thought.
Way, way higher than I thought. I thought it was going to get kind of trashed for being a Dark Souls clone. Mm-hmm. People really liking it. Allegedly, I don't know because I don't play them. Allegedly, the hardest of Bloodborne, Dark Souls, Dark Souls, Dark Souls 3.
Great.
like, I heard that the amount of punished you get just for being impatient is like ridiculous.
These are the types of games.
I'll check it out.
I think we've said it before where, or maybe it was you talking about Bloodborne. You don't throw Neo or Bloodborne or a Souls game in the mix while you're playing Kingdom Hearts and you're playing
Persona. You need to be in that mindset, and that's going to be your life for until you beat
this. This is one of those like habit breaker games, because if you come into these other games where you have all these kind of easy way outs, or maybe death isn't like forced upon you in some of these games where, oh, my health will recharge or this or that, like, this game will break you. I'm not even going to finish that sentence. It'll just break you. So, you really have to play this type of game and this only, finish it, or multiple playthroughs if you have the time, I guess, and then move on to the next game. Yeah. So that's what I'm doing. I know I won't finish both Tales and Yakuza by then, but I'm going to put a pause in those because, like I said, this early start of the year is one after the other, so unfortunately, I think I'm going to leave a lot of games at like 50%, 75%, and then hope to catch it after the early part of the year storm is over, May, basically. But saying all that, I will have to pause my current games if I'm not finished and just play this.
Get through that, yeah.
Because this isn't one I want to leave at 50% and then
Yeah, you'll never be able to come back.
Just be like, why? Especially since
you'll just have to restart.
Like you mentioned, it might be the hardest one.
Yeah, that's what I'm hearing. I don't know.
And this is another one where I will be buying the guide for. I know I've showed you at least the Dark Souls 3 one. I think you still have
your
Bloodborne one. It's a must. It's pretty tough unless you go to the guy that I talked about. I'm sure he'll play it too, since it's even more Japanese based than the Souls games. It's good to go to some of these YouTubers and stuff like that who are going to make a complete walkthrough. But man, is it frustrating to fight the same guy the 20th time and still not have figured it out.
Mm-hmm.
These games don't not tell you stuff, but they don't drape it, across the screen. And
there's
say,
there's literally no hand holding. The information's there. But you got to find it yourself.
Yeah, that's one small knock against Resident Evil, because if you die a couple of times, a loading screen will say,
I know,
maybe you should hit X, or maybe you should use this thing in the boss fight.
That was a complaint I remember hearing. People being like, yeah, I died once in the boss fight, and it just told me how to beat them.
Yeah, these games are more likely to have a load screen that says, you suck. The good thing is, from what I heard about this, versus a Bloodborne, or versus some of the older Souls games, when you die and have to respawn, it doesn't take 10 years.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
That's a real thing about Bloodborne, is it takes a while.
Yeah,
like,
it's discouraging.
Loading screen, and you're sitting there venting for 10 minutes. Why did I die? Blah, blah, blah. This sucks. I have to repeat a few hours. Not this game.
It gives you too long to think about shutting it off.
I think it might have been someone on Kotaku doing an early preview, but I forget the site. But that was someone's question. Hey, is it frustrating after you die? And he said, I hardly notice. A transition, I guess. So awesome. But yeah, really excited about this game. Let's just finish this list out. Sure. February 9th, which is Thursday. Warp Ball. Warp Ball is a fast-paced multiplayer sports game in a futuristic setting for 1 to 4 players. This game is loosely based on the rules of football, but adds teleportation and special abilities for the PC. Okay. Brutal for PC. PC port of a PS4 indie title from last year. Brutal is a modern reimagining of the classic ASC 2 dungeon crawler with roguelike elements. With permadeath as a key feature, players choose their hero, then descend into a procedurally generated world constructed entirely from ASC II code. I don't know. ASCII.
Okay.
More
words Gareth's just making up.
Alone with you, PC. Another PS4 to PC port. Being stranded is one of the most intense situations to be in, and alone with you, players are forced to deal with just that. You're the last remaining survivor on a terraforming colony with limited time and only one escape pod. The catch is that it doesn't work, and you have to scramble to repair it before the colony crumbles. Sounds like a one-and-done kind of game.
I don't know.
Unless there's multiple ways to build this escape pod.
February
10th. LEGO Dimensions, LEGO Batman, Excalibur Batman, and Knight Rider Fun Packs. Available on all platforms.
I forgot about these.
More LEGO brick tie-ins for the LEGO Dimensions game, each pack coming with its own figures and content.
I love LEGO Dimensions.
LEGO Batman's pack are obviously to promote the new movie, and Knight Rider is a nod to the 80s TV fans. Who doesn't want a LEGO David Hasselhoff?
Yeah, I really like LEGO Dimensions. I think it's the best LEGO game because it's so open and you can get exactly the pieces you want. That being said, they do story packs. There was Ghostbusters, the 2016 Ghostbusters movie. So I sure didn't buy that. And then there was Fantastic Beasts was the next one, which I bought. I still haven't opened it, but I want to play through that. And then I forgot the next one is LEGO Batman, which that movie's getting good reviews too. But the next one's LEGO Batman, so I'm going to have to get that. Totally forgot about that.
I could see it in your eyes when I said it.
Yeah, I'm kind of excited.
This one kind of perked me up a little bit, but that's because the name's kind of similar. Crypt of the Necrodancer, Xbox One. I thought Rise of the Necromancer, which is the Diablo 3 patch coming later this year, that has my favorite class.
This game is sweet.
This, I have no idea what this is. But it's for the Xbox One. Action indie RPG previously released on PC and PS4 2 years ago and 1 year ago, respectively. Join our hero Cadence as she battles her way through the Necrodancer's dungeon in search of her missing father. On the way, she faces methodical monsters all moving to the same musical beat she's been cursed to follow.
Yeah, so it basically, if you could picture it, it's like Zelda, the original Zelda, top down, but there's a grid. You can see the grid, and basically everything you do has to go to the beat of the music. It'll be like boop, 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 boop. So you have to walk, boop, 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 boop. You have to turn like that, and all the combat is done like that.
Okay.
So if you mess up, you're going to get hit or killed. Very cool game.
And last and maybe least, February 11th, Colina Legacy PC. Colina Legacy is a horror video game with puzzle elements. Control Alex as he struggles to grasp what has happened in the house on top of the hill where his grandmother once lived.
A riveting description of the game. Literally no clue what that game is.
Colina.
Cool. Anything else you want to say?
Nope. Excited about the BioWare IP. At first, I thought it was going to be KOTOR 3, but when they said over and over and over
new
and over
IP,
and over and over that it's new this, new that, then, yeah, it's not an old revival of one of their other series. I hope it turns out to be a Destiny killer. That would be cool because I like the concept.
I think we're going to see Destiny 2 this year, so we'll see how that goes. Yeah. Because Destiny 2 might just be insane. It's quite possible.
Might be, but
I don't think they'll do the same thing again.
Yeah, if there's one group of people who can take that idea away from them, maybe not first person shooter aspect of it, but like big open narrative world, MMO on a console sort of thing, BioWare is probably one of the leading candidates of that. So we'll see.
Yeah, I'm most excited just about Injustice 2. I want to know all the characters. Hopefully, I don't know, it's May, so it would be a little off, but I would love just a character a week or, you know they got to save a couple for events and things, but I really want that list to be true.
Really wish we could add a few weeks on the calendar for this year, because this gaming schedule,
it's rough.
I can't leave the house once I get home.
I was worried, but I got through all my Kingdom Hearts, so now I got to figure out what I'm going to do. It's to the backlog with me, but I might have to play Neo.
Oh, yeah.
So that's it for this episode of the Press X Podcast. Be sure to share and subscribe to be alerted when all of our videos go live. Thank you for being here, says Kellen. He's a no-show, but thank you for being here, Nick.
Yep, as always.
Yeah, and thank you guys for watching. We'll speak with you next time.
Rest in peace, Kellen.
Aw.
Sleep in peace.
It might be rest in peace after we eat these peppers. We'll have to see.
I am not on ER duty.